From the earliest times, man has always had the desire to fly. In vain attempts to realize this aim, certain hapless individuals even tried to take to the air strapped to flimsy wings, throwing themselves recklessly off high buildings and clifftops. However misguided and even comical these experiments seem today, in their time they had their own rational basis. Attempts to fly were looked on, quite reasonably, as being highly dangerous exploits. But in some cases, the fear was not of crashing to the ground, but of actually flying too high. Take the ancient myth of Icarus, one of the earliest examples of man's attempts to fly.
Whilst trying to escape from the island of Crete, the inventor Daedalus designed a pair of wings for himself and his son Icarus. The plan was successful, but very soon Icarus became so enchanted with this new freedom that he flew higher and higher. He rose so high that the sun melted the wax supporting his wings, and he plummeted to the ground and was killed. Leonardo da Vinci is often described as a pioneer of the theory of aeronautics. These early sketches show that he too believed that man could fly with the aid of flappable wings like that of a bird. He also realized that to sustain any length of flight, man would also have to use the power of his leg muscles, pushing pedals. Compared to many other sciences, aeronautics was slow to develop, and it wasn't until the 1890s that a correct formula of basic aerodynamic principles emerged. The very first fully thought-out experiments had been undertaken in the early 19th century by Sir George Cayley, who's been called the father of aerial navigation. Cayley pioneered a technique of attaching wing surfaces to the end of a rod, which could be made to whirl horizontally, thus enabling him to study the effect of lifting forces upon the wing surfaces. During the second half of the 19th century, engines and power plants underwent rapid development, tempting more and more pioneers to commit themselves to the air in barely controllable and totally untested heavier-than-air machines. The most remarkable of these was the Eon, built by Clement Ader. He became the first man to rise from ground level in a powered aircraft, even though it was only for a brief flight of about 150 feet. The problem of attaining enough lift from a wing's surface was one which many men tried to counter. These flying Venetian blinds, consisting of many long, thin wings stacked on top of each other, did little for the budding aviator, but were highly amusing to the crowds that gathered to watch their attempts. During the 19th century, public enthusiasm for aeronautics kept growing, as these intrepid birdmen in their weird contraptions tried in vain to take to the air. Thank you. in the late 1880s, flying was at last put on a proper, theoretical and practical footing by one Otto Lilienthal. Here he can be seen in what's not that far removed from today's modern hang gliders. Inspired by Lilienthal's example, a young Scotsman by the name of Percy Pilcher developed the theory and practice even further by designing a glider which introduced modifications, including the use of wheeled landing gear and a takeoff technique using a tow line. It could be claimed that the accolade of the true invention of the aeroplane could go to two men, the Wright brothers. These two intrepid brothers, Wilbur and Orville, lived in Dayton, Ohio. In 1896, having run a successful bicycle business, they turned their skills and resources to the quest for flight. In 1900, with help from the Frenchman Octave Chanute, the Wright brothers built and flew the first of their own biplane gliders. Was followed by a second and a third. These aircraft were the real prototypes of what aviation was going to become, and perhaps what is the greatest contribution ever made to the history of manned flight. Because the third glider had movable wing flaps for turning and a movable rudder for steering. For the first time in history, an aircraft could bank and turn and roll back to level flight without loss of control. The next task was to set about building a powered aircraft. Unable to find a suitable lightweight power plant, they built their own, a 12-horsepower petrol engine which would drive two pusher propellers, which they also designed and built. In 1903, the Wright Flyer was ready. And on the 17th of December, Orville Wright made the first powered, sustained and controlled flight ever. It lasted for a mere 12 seconds, but at long last, the hurdle had been overcome. Man could fly. This was followed by the Flyer 2, which completed a flight lasting more than 5 minutes. Flyer 3 was far superior and remained airborne for half an hour, circling and flying a figure of eight circuit. By 1905, with the success of the Wright brothers, the enthusiasm for flying had been emulated in Europe, and such eminent pioneers as Captain Ferdinand Ferber, Archdeacon Gabriel Voisin, the Brazilian Alberto Santos Dumont, and the famous Louis Blériot. They'd all achieved milestones in the history of flight. 1909 marked the final emergence of the aeroplane as a fully practical mode of transport. This year holds a special place in aeronautical history. It was the year of the very first aviation show. This air show was held at Reims in France on the 22nd to the 29th of August 1909. In all, 38 aircraft entered, although in fact only 23 managed to take off, including three of the Wright's aircraft. All sorts of records were achieved. A top speed of 47 miles an hour, the highest altitude of 508 feet, and the greatest non-stop distance of almost 112 miles. The Reims meeting established the importance and viability of the aeroplane and marked the start of many such events, with manufacturers trying to outdo each other in improvements and refinements. Aeroplanes began to be used in an ever-increasing variety of roles. The birth of the aircraft carrier emerged on the 14th of November 1910, when an American, Eugene Ely, flew a Curtiss biplane from the cruiser Birmingham off the coast of Virginia, USA. although experts might say that, in fact, the first flight from a plane at sea was made by Samuel Langley's aircraft in 1903, when it was catapulted from this makeshift houseboat aerodrome. Also in 1910, the very first float plane was airborne, and in the same year, bombing trials were made over targets marked out like ships. It was also in 1910 when two aircraft had the very first mid-air collision near Milan in Italy.
During those early years of aviation, many exciting pioneer flights were made. Amongst the most courageous were those in which pilots used fragile and unreliable aircraft to cover considerable distances with minimal navigational aids, poor weather information, and no established search and rescue system. Flights across water were even more dangerous. A forced landing on a field was a much safer proposition than ditching in the sea. In 1909, the Daily Mail offered a prize of £1,000 for the first crossing of the English Channel in an aeroplane.
A number of eminent pilots attempted the crossing, including Wilbur Wright and Hubert Latham, but without success. That was until the 25th of July, when Frenchman Louis Blériot set off from near Calais in the Blériot X-1. 37 minutes and 12 seconds later, he made a heavy landing on a grassy hill near Dover Castle, having covered a distance of 23.5 miles. As with the Channel crossing, the Atlantic was also promoted by the Daily Mail, with a prize of £10,000. Although this was delayed by the outbreak of World War I, many teams planned flights. On the 14th of June 1919, two British pilots, John Alcock and Arthur Whitton Brown, flew a converted Vickers Vimy from Newfoundland to Ireland. They covered the distance of 1,890 miles in 16 hours and 27 minutes, flying at an altitude of about 4,000 feet. Their landing in Ireland was rather anticlimactic, for the field in which they'd chosen to land proved to be too soft, and the four-wheeled undercarriage dug in and the aircraft nosed over.
In recognition of this momentous achievement, Alcock and Brown were knighted by King George V. One of the most astounding flights in history required not only a superb pilot, but also an aircraft of unusual endurance and reliability.
This was the first solo crossing of the Atlantic by Charles Lindbergh on the 20th of May 1927. His aircraft was the Spirit of St. Louis. The non-stop journey was from New York to Paris, a staggering distance then of 3,610 miles. Over 33 hours later, with minimal navigational equipment and having been awake for two nights in the air, Lindbergh touched down to a tremendous reception at Le Bourget Airfield in Paris.
Lindbergh's achievement was second to none. It marked the accomplishment of what an individual can achieve alone. It also marked the spirit and tenacity of all pioneer aviators that had gone before. Throughout aviation history, one constant factor has been relied upon to spur advancement in aircraft design: war. Before the outbreak of World War I, the use of aircraft as a weapon of war had not been given much attention. The aircraft of the day seemed too flimsy and unreliable to provide any form of operational use in wartime. But there was one task to which it was considered that the aircraft might be suited: reconnaissance.
For over 100 years, observers in balloons had proved that they could usefully spy on the enemy and report movements in a way which would prove impossible at ground level. In 1912, the British decided to test options for the best machine for short-range reconnaissance. They opted for the de Havilland BE-2 tandem seat biplane, and these were used in large numbers during the first 3 years of the war. By 1915, much of the air reconnaissance work was carried out with the aid of cameras. These were either mounted vertically in the floor of the aircraft or simply held over the side by the observer. With frozen fingers, anti-aircraft shell bursts, and the force of the slipstream, operating these cameras proved to be no easy task. But as time went by, these cameras were gradually replaced by more reliable automatic models. By the end of the war in 1918, the German Air Force was taking on average 4,000 photos a day, and the newly formed RAF had no less than 9,000 cameras in action. Between the two world wars, there was constant development in the design of aerial cameras, and also in aerial mapping and survey, and of course, vast improvements in the aircraft themselves. By the outbreak of World War II, the Luftwaffe had 1/5 of its total force in aerial reconnaissance, with machines such as the HS-126 and the Fokker Wulf 189. They'd already taken photographic coverage of all British military installations, and thousands of missions had been flown over Poland, Norway, and France. But once the conflict started, the German crews found little time for reconnaissance. Allied command of the air denied them any opportunity, until in the closing months, the twin jet AR-234B and the Messerschmitt 262A appeared as reconnaissance versions that no Allied fighter could match. In contrast, the Allies had thousands of reconnaissance aircraft airborne daily throughout the war. The RAF pioneered the photo reconnaissance fighter, using the superb Mustang for low-level work and the Spitfire PRX-1 for high-level sorties, along with the Mosquito. These aircraft could cover targets as far as Berlin or Prague in daylight. The RAF PR aircraft took many millions of photographs all over Europe, on which appeared many Nazi secrets, such as the V1 flying bomb and the V2 rocket. Meanwhile, the United States Air Force and Navy also used camera-equipped versions of many famous fighter and bomber aircraft. Electronic intelligence, or ELINT, was another important aspect of reconnaissance. The gathering of information on enemy radar and electronic installations. The first ELINT raid was carried out by a Spitfire on the 22nd of February 1941, racing at treetop level over a German radar installation. A true ELINT began when, on the 3rd of December 1942, a converted Wellington succeeded in luring up radar-equipped enemy night fighters. Before being shot to ribbons, the Wellington crew managed to transmit back full details of the German radar wavelength and pulse frequency. Ever since then, ELINT has been one of the most vital reconnaissance tasks of any air force. During the 1950s, the United States Air Force and Navy sent out aircraft packed with ELINT equipment to bring back details of the radars, communications, and electronic installations around the Soviet Union, flying deep into Soviet airspace. It's also believed, but not officially admitted, that the RAF carried out similar missions using the Mosquito and then later the Canberra jet bombers. Over the years, many of the US aircraft were shot down by the Soviet MiG fighters. The increasingly more effective early warning systems of the Soviet Union proved to be difficult to penetrate. To counteract this problem, the CIA, who were interested in Soviet nuclear weaponry and missile developments, funded a project to build a new aircraft, specifically to fly ultra-high sorties over the Soviet Union. The Lockheed U-2. The combination of a powerful jet engine and a sailplane-like wing gave this aircraft an amazing rate of climb, a maximum ceiling of 70,000 feet and a very long range. By 1959, the aircraft was no longer a secret. The Russians had become accustomed to tracking the U-2, but no fighter could reach it. That was until 1960. On the 1st of May, CIA pilot Gary Powers took off from Pakistan, intending to take photographs and L-INF recordings over the Soviet Union before landing in Norway. However, over the Siberian city of Sverdlovsk, he was intercepted and shot down by the new Russian V-750VK surface-to-air missile. The U-2 was no longer immune from interception. They were continued in service, however. More powerful variants with new mission electronics were being used in the Gulf War in 1991, and more recently, monitoring the conflict in the former Yugoslavia. In response to the earlier threat in 1960 from surface-to-air missiles, the Lockheed SR-71 Blackbird was designed. It could fly even higher than the U-2 and sustain astonishing speeds in excess of Mach 3. Aviation had come a long way since the days of the Wright brothers. This fantastic aircraft entered service in 1968 and carried out global strategic missions at speeds in excess of 2,000 miles per hour and at heights of above 80,000 feet. With the exception of rockets, no other aircraft has come anywhere near the SR-71's sustained speed and altitude capability. And even now, some 30 years after its first flights, the aircraft still looks incredibly futuristic. The aircraft were prematurely retired by the United States Air Force in 1990, and six of them were mothballed. Although there's now speculation that a modified version, capable of speeds in excess of Mach 4, is about to replace them. Today, one of the most important class of reconnaissance aircraft is hard at work. The AEW, Airborne Early Warning Aircraft. The best known of these is the Boeing E-3 Sentry. The E-3, based on a civilian version, has a large rotor dome mounted above the fuselage and carries many tons of electronics. Carrying a crew of up to 24 at a height of 7 miles or more, the E-3 can remain airborne for 12 hours, much more with in-flight refueling. This flying battle station is not only able to study in detail friendly and hostile airspace, but can also direct all military effort, both on the defensive and offensive, in a way that was never before possible. This capability was clearly demonstrated during the 1991 Gulf War. The E-3s coordinated hundreds of aircraft, performing every kind of mission from combat air patrols to search and rescue operations deep behind enemy lines. It was the US Navy that actually pioneered the AEW system during World War II. After being subjected to the Japanese kamikaze attacks, they found that shipborne radars were unable to give adequate warning of incoming enemy aircraft. By fitting Avenger torpedo bombers with a radar dome under the belly. It's necessary for the US Navy that their AEW aircraft are able to operate off the decks of the carrier fleet, and therefore need to be much smaller than the Sentry. The Grumman E-2 Hawkeye took over the role in the early 1960s, and is still used operationally today.
The idea that flying machines might drop bombs has been written about for centuries. It's thought that Napoleon had his own air force at Waterloo, dropping bombs over the sides of balloons to an unsuspecting enemy below. The first effective bombers were airships. The Zeppelin, Schutterlanz, and Parseval ships of the German Imperial Navy were engaged in practice bombing before the start of World War I. As the use of aircraft as weapons became more commonplace, so did the use of bombs.
They were hung from specially designed racks, at first at the side of the cockpit, and then later from the underside of the fuselage or wing. Releasing the bombs was crude. It was effected by pulling a wire, and having the bombs fused to explode on impact was dangerous, especially when they often jolted free on takeoff. Some were fitted with safety pins, which could be withdrawn by the pilot pulling another string. But by 1915, properly designed bombs with good aerodynamics and ballistic properties were produced. These could fall accurately, point first, with a small fan driven by the slipstream, which unscrewed a safety device making the bomb fused. The pioneers of the bomber were Russian and Italian. Pride of place must go to Igor Sikorsky. He built the first ever four-engined biplane in 1913. Which went on to form the famed IM class of giant warplanes. These aircraft not only equipped the world's first heavy bomber unit, but pioneered the concept of strategic bombing. In Britain, there were no bombers at the start of the war, and the Royal Flying Corps had no thought of such machines. But the Royal Naval Air Service was more far-sighted. In 1914, they commissioned the construction of the Handley Page 0100, first flown in December 1915. This was followed by the more powerful 0400. And by the end of the war, the RAF's Independent Air Force took delivery of the much more powerful V1500, which had four engines and could carry a bomb load of 7,500 pounds. But by then, the Germans had taken delivery of the R series of bombers, and these were by far the greatest bombers of World War I. The RV-1 variant was equipped with four engines. It carried a crew of seven, with onboard radio navigation direction finder, oxygen, comprehensive flight instruments, and even a simple autopilot system. Wingspan was colossal, 138 feet, the largest of any service bomber until the B-29 Superfortress some 30 years later.
Between the two world wars, bombers advanced, with improved engines, new structures, retractable landing gear, variable pitch propellers, and the power-driven gun turret. Throughout the 1920s, aircraft developed slowly, using metal structures instead of wood, but still braced with wires and covered with fabric. It was only in the Soviet Union where the bomber took a dramatic change.
This was because of the setting up by the German Junkers Company of an aircraft plant near Moscow. Under the direction of Andrei N. Tupolev, they produced an excellent twin-engined monoplane bomber, the ANT-4, put into service in 1925 by the Soviet Air Fleet as the TB-1. This aircraft had a completely unbraced all-metal wing. 1 month later, a new version was ordered, the ANT-6. This first flew in 1930. It was a monster of an aircraft. With an all-metal wing, four engines, tandem wheel landing gears, and no fewer than five machine gun stations, it could carry a bomb load of up to 12,800 pounds. Meanwhile, in the United States, Boeing had also been working on new bomber designs. They came up with the Boeing B-9. A large bomber with stressed skin structure. This aircraft had so many gun positions that the newspapers called it a flying fortress. The name stuck, and gradually the mark was developed. By the time it entered service in 1937, it was designated the B-17. In Germany, however, it was a different story again. The Luftwaffe had equipped itself exclusively with medium twin-engine bombers, the largest being the Heinkel 111, the lightest being the Dornier 17, and the newest was the Junkers 88. Heinkel and the Dornier first saw action in Spain, and because they encountered no determined modern fighters, this left the Germans satisfied that their bomber force was adequate for any future war, despite their light defensive armament. The Russians also concentrated on smaller tactical bombers, the Tupolev SB-2 being one of the best and was far superior to the RAF's new Blenheim and Wellington bombers.
On the 1st of September 1939, Germany invaded Poland in what became the outbreak of World War II. Their Luftwaffe was fairly well equipped with Dornier DO-17, Heinkel HE-111, and the Junkers JU-88 level bombers. They also had the Henschel HS-123 and Junkers JU-87 dive bombers. The Polish Air Force was effectively destroyed in the air or grounded by the bombing of their airfields. Lines of communication were cut, dumps and reinforcements attacked, headquarters pounded from the air, and frontline centers of resistance were crushed. The bomber had proved effective in warfare.
Britain's first bombing raid was on the German naval installation at Wilhelmshaven. RAF force of Blenheims and Wellingtons were pounced on by German fighters, and seven aircraft were lost as a result. This indicated a stern lesson that in daylight raids, bombers would be incapable of warding off enemy fighters. It was decided that night bombing, although less accurate, would be the way forward for the RAF. were to learn the same lesson that they'd inflicted on the Poles, Norwegians, Dutch, Belgians, French and British. Without air superiority over the target, daylight bombing is a costly business. And this lesson was hard learnt in the Battle of Britain in 1940. A new type of bomber battle began, one that was to continue for the rest of the war. On one side, the bombers would attack in mass formations, trying to find their targets in the dark to inflict heavy damage. On the other side, ground defenses attempted to conceal targets by decoys and used ever-increasingly sophisticated methods to jam or distort the attacker's electronic aids. Whilst the US Army concentrated on developing the B-17 and its later partner, the B-24 Liberator, Britain also turned its attention to producing larger four-engined bombers. There were three types: the short Stirling, the Handley Page Halifax, and the legendary Avro Lancaster.
DR compass, set to magnetic. Trim, set for takeoff. Propellers, all fine. Fuel, numbers 1 and 2 tanks selected, booster pumps on. Flaps, set for takeoff.
When Air Marshal Arthur T. Harris was appointed as its commander-in-chief in February 1942, Bomber Command was gradually transformed into a force which made the Luftwaffe bomber fleet look puny in comparison.
Let the Nazis take good note of the Western horizon.
Between February 1942 and March 1944, Bomber Command dropped some 195,000 tons of bombs on German cities and lost 4,285 aircraft in the process. One of the milestones in this whirlwind campaign was the first 1,000 bomber raid on Cologne, the 31st of May, 1942. States Army Air Force heavy bombers from England. The heavily defended mighty B-17s and B-24s began a series of daylight raids against strategic targets. This marked the start of a double offensive. The RAF would attack by night, followed by the US Army Air Force attacking by day. A constant bombardment of Germany's defenses and strategic installations. The US Army Air Force was to suffer heavy losses. And again, it was made crystal clear that any daylight raids would have to be accompanied by fighter escorts. But as yet, there was no long-range fighter available that could accompany the bomber force deep into Europe.
Oh.
There were endless raids carried out by bombers during World War II, many of them worthy of a place in history. Dreadful numbers of lives were lost as a result of the bomber. In just a relatively short space of time, since the first attempts by man to fly, the aircraft had become an awesome and formidable weapon. Most formidable of all was one which was to bring about the end of the world conflict. One aircraft carrying one bomb, the ultimate aerial weapon.
The Boeing B-29 Superfortress was technically the most advanced aircraft of World War II. It was first in service with the USAF in 1944 and operated superbly. In ever-increasing numbers, they pounded Japan from the air, devastating her cities, food production, power systems, transportation networks, and industrial areas. As a result, they made it almost impossible for Japan to sustain her war efforts. However, despite the success of these conventional raids, it was to take a new weapon to put a final end to the war. On the 6th of August, 1945, a B-29, the Enola Gay, dropped the first ever atomic weapon used in anger on the Japanese city of Hiroshima. By the end of World War II, it was obvious that the future lay with the gas turbine engine. Germany had actually built jet bombers and had got them into action. The purpose-built AR-234B and the Hitler-inspired ME-262A. By 1945, a whole range of much larger jet bombers were on the drawing boards in the United States. The North American B-45 Tornado entered service with the newly created United States Air Force in 1948. At around the same time, Britain too had been developing a new series of jet bombers designed to carry a nuclear and conventional bomb load, the V-bombers. Three types were built, the Vickers Valiant, the Handley Page Victor, Delta-winged Avro Vulcan. By 1953, as with the United States, it was clear to the British Air Ministry that a standoff missile would be needed to help deliver nuclear weapons to heavily defended targets. New versions of the Victor and the Vulcan were introduced, both with greater power and larger wings. In the USA, the gigantic eight-engined Boeing B-52 appeared, and considerable effort was also placed upon building supersonic bombers. The last of the world's high-speed, high-altitude bombers to come off the design boards was the American 3B-70 Valkyrie. This aircraft was capable of speeds in excess of Mach 3. It soon became apparent that in order to penetrate defended airspace, the bomber no longer had to fly higher to evade detection. Had to fly lower and at high speed. In fact, it had to almost hug the ground to get in low under the radar defenses. Though the B-70 and the B-52 could both do this reasonably well, they were becoming inferior to aircraft which had been specifically designed to the task. One such aircraft, which although started out as being a design for a fighter, was the General Dynamics F-111. This aircraft, after overcoming many defects and design faults, became an outstanding low-level strike aircraft. It pioneered the use of automatic terrain following with radar, and its swing-wing configuration was a great influence on the designers of the much later Panavia Tornado. After the US Air Force introduced the B-52, there was a gap of 20 years before they introduced the next generation. In 1974, the Rockwell B-1 was finally flown after being 10 years in planning. This bomber was designed for a specific purpose: to deliver a nuclear deterrent that could, without fail, strike back after a Russian attack by missiles on the United States. Should an attack look imminent on the radar screens in the USA, it was thought risky to counterattack with a missile. What if the alarm turned out to be a false one? But the B-1 could be airborne within 2 to 3 minutes, getting the aircraft into the safety of the sky. From there, should the attack prove real, it could hit back. Modern bombers are packed with electronic defenses. Systems that give warnings of hostile radars, emitters to interfere with hostile communications, and a mass of other penetration aids, such as chaff flares and active jammer payloads. Chaff is what the RAF called window in World War II, comprising of millions of small strips of metal foil, which is used to confuse the enemy radar systems. In modern-day warfare, except the longest strategic missions, there's no longer a need for purpose-designed bombers. Modern fighters, such as the Tornado and the F-15 Eagle, can carry such heavy weapon loads that they can fly all of the required attack missions, backed up by close support or anti-tank aircraft.
Since the invention of radar, aircraft have been vulnerable to detection, whether flying at night or in clouds, or even hundreds of miles from their intended targets. Most aircraft have plenty of flat surfaces, and these make for excellent reflectors for the electromagnetic waves produced by powerful radar transmitters. But what could be done to counteract the problem? It was Lockheed that came up with the solution. We'll be right back.
F-117 Nighthawk, the world's first invisible aircraft. Its surfaces are designed to deflect or absorb radar. It has jet inlet screens that deflect the heat emissions from the turbines. It also has specially treated cockpit surfaces and thin horizontal jet pipes that cool the gases before dispersing. All of these go to help make the Nighthawk virtually undetectable, especially when flown at night. The pilot has an advanced infrared forward-looking system. The weapon bays open and close in a fraction of a second so as not to show up on radar. And most importantly, all of the aircraft's navigation and attack sensors are entirely passive. In other words, they receive but don't transmit. Once the pilot's located the target and locked on, the weapon's release system takes over automatically and is guided by the laser under the nose of the aircraft, which illuminates the target with an invisible beam. The aeroplane has come a long way since the string and canvas days of the Wright brothers.